this point, we're talking about this body of work, or the body of work that this represents. Anybody have a point they want to raise? I don't. I just got it. I was going through an adage we have to the garage, which is it really is stores my kid, but it stores all the stuff that they haven't taken it up. And a little bit of the furniture. And I noticed over the past few years I've been storing acorns. And so I've been shoveling out acorns from this land space and looking around and saying, what the heck is in here? Anyway, I'm not finding acorns and stuff. And I found a painting from college. And so I thought I'd bring work today and talk about progression to this. This is the first. I majored in architecture. This was in City College. I majored in architecture. David suffered through physics, calculus, and other things to get to the design portion, which I thought was what I was going to do. I was going to be an architect. At that point, I wanted something more constructive, which is my parents thought more than mine. Before that, I went to the Bronx High School of Science, which was where smart kids go who aren't interested in the arts. I was interested in the arts. My parents didn't want me to go to the music and art because that was in the big neighborhood, blah, blah, blah. We're going to do some artists. Sputnik, the Russians, engineering. So architecture was a good compromise between engineering and making pictures. And so I majored in architecture, and it took me a few years. I finally got a 5-credit course in design after physics, after calculus. And after that 5-credit course, 5 or 5, the teacher said to me, I don't know where his father is, he's in Europe, Jan Tereshenko, I remember his name, I remember my first grade teacher's name. He said, Leonard, you're a lousy designer, you're going to get an F for this course, but if you promise to draw architecture, I'll give you a D. I said, fine. I went home, I started drawing architecture, then they went on. My parents, they could talk this way in those days. My mother said, see, there's a war going on. Vietnam War. North campus engineers were for a war, wrong war. South campus is hard, people. So I said, I'm moving from the North campus to the South campus, I'm going to be a law major, not a major anymore. My mother's reaction was, oh my God, you're going to be a faggot or a communist. So I was pretty much, now I think back, I was pretty much under the thumb of my parents' ideas, and I felt like I should have been, and that was fine. And then, so this was the first art course I had. After drawing, I had painting. I think I took them both at the same time, because I was trying to play catch up after 2.5 years of other stuff. And so I took this painting course, and then we painted a couple of things. And at the end, we painted a self-portrait. And I found this in the attic, and it's never been on a wall since I moved out of my mother's house. It's been stored in her house, and she and I moved it to my house. And I looked at the other painting and thought, it's not bad, really. This is me now. It's like, boy, you've really gotten sort of different. Anyways, you're not as naive and going, kind of depressed and old. Well, the picture, I don't consider this a portrait, but it is. I consider it one picture that I use myself. Because the scale is difficult, it's difficult to face when you're right there. You just have to be all wrong. And I'm really trying for a representation of this image and not something that's going to be sure. So I use a photograph to get proportions and details. I project from an overhead projector. I go through the computer, I make the image, I print the image, I put it in the overhead, I project it. I get the basic outline. I look at the photograph for a while, and then the photograph's gone, and I'm making the image. Not a photograph anymore. It's something else. So I need to quote Larry Rivers. Somebody asked him, this is what I read anyway. The question was, why do you use your mother Bertha in these paintings? She's a large, old woman, nude. Why do you use your mother? And she says, she's cheap, quiet, and available. And I go, well, I'm cheap, quiet, and available, and I'm the only face I've got. So I use my face a lot in not so flattering ways because I can, because it's easier for me to find me than for somebody else. So
So anyway, this is, you know, me in 68. And this is me in 2010. That's also me in 2010. That picture was taken about 10 years ago. Maybe less, I'm not sure. So that's the first one. The second picture I want to show you. So that's, I graduated college in 74, master's degree in 74, left New York, moved to Iowa, started teaching at Iowa State University. And I'm skipping from 74 to 84. In 84, we were raising two kids. And I wasn't painting, I was teaching. And I said, well, if you're not painting, you're not a painter. I think I made a painting the whole year 1983. You know, we were raising two kids, teaching full time. So I couldn't really get much painting done. So I thought, well, if you're not a painting, you're not a painter. You're just teaching about it. So I decided in 84 I was going to do a painting of the day. Only because I grew up with George Orwell's 84, and it seemed like a terrible future, which actually it's gotten a lot worse than you thought, I think. But it was something that was significant in 84. My father was really sick in 84. He died in 85 or 6. So I was thinking, I gotta do something about 1984. So I did a painting a day for a year, and I did it at night. Usually 11 o'clock, so I would start. And maybe it would take a half hour, or 2 hours, or 3 hours, and then another more. And it was, in order, I think, well, you know, as a photographer, let's say, you can take, I don't know what the percentages of success in a photographer, but even if it's 10%, and hopefully painters would work better than that, because it's not just a snapshot of the work, right? Let's say it's down to 10%. If I had a 10% success record, I'll have 36 pictures at the end of the year. And also, if I do a lousy picture, what's accidental? I'm doing another one tomorrow. So I lost a few of the other. And I just banked on the odds that if I spit out anything that I've done 66 times, which is easier, I'll get 36 paintings out of this. So anyway, I learned a lot in 64. I taught myself a lot. I also became very sick because I was using turpentine and wax, melting it down to make an encaustic, which I didn't have to heat, which was like Crisco. And I was working in an attic, and after a year of sitting in this attic with all this encaustic drying and all this turpentine, I was having a lot of problems, and my mental state was terrible. So by the end of the year, I was doing these really depressing pictures, and I realized that I was getting ill from the chemicals. So I stopped using oils, because now I get allergic to oils. So I switched to a cold encaustic, which doesn't require any solid, and that's where this comes in. I was working with encaustics just because 84 told me to do that. And then in about 92, maybe? No, not even, still in the 80s, I was driving a babysitter home, and I saw these silos in the moonlight on the way home. And I went back that night, and that was 84, exactly. I went back that night, and I had to do something of the day, and it was late. I did this silo in encaustic. I can't remember now, it was a hot wax or cold wax, so it doesn't matter. But what I like this painting. I still have it. Nobody else had bought it. That's why I still have it. But I come to like it because I get to see it a lot. And it's up close, it really does radiate. And it does some nice things with the surface. I'm very into surface. I discovered in 84 different ways of working the surface, that the surface becomes as interesting as the image, and I wanted that. And I'm still engaged with the surface. I find that makes the painting more beautiful. I grew up in the 1567, and I grew up with abstract expressions, abstraction, I feel kind of sacrilegious almost to representation of art at this point. My saving grace, the way I justify it in a sense, is that it's still got surface, it's still got the object that I'm looking at, the piece of paper, as opposed to the illusion. So the technique satisfies me in that area, that it's still a physical being. It's not just a picture of something. At least that's my hope. If it's just a picture of an old lady, okay, it's a picture of an old lady. But I'd rather it be, when we get up close, something beyond just a picture of an old lady. So that's why and how surface is important to me. So this was something I kind of think I'm working on. But I had to get away from the oils and the wax and all that. And so I moved to gouache. Gouache is an opaque watercolor. And the nice thing is, it's color. It comes back to life whenever you want it to, which is good and bad. I found that I really enjoyed working with something that always came back to life. In other words, if I painted it blue and I put something over it, that blue is going to come back, the line will come out over the other color. Or, you know, it wasn't like acrylics where you put something down, it's dead, you put something over it, that's what you now see. This was every time you touched it and got it wet enough, it came back. And so, again, the surface, and it's the paint, and it's the physicality that really intrigued me. And I was married to the grid probably because I was a graphic designer before I started teaching, and I taught graphic design for 30 years along with design and other things. And so the grid is God's avatar of design. The grid is God, and I really believed in it and just worked as much as I could with the grid. I can see the relationship now between, you know, these two things, but I probably like the silo because of that grid thing and how the grid became a circular thing, a cylindrical thing. And more you get, it becomes one of those two, scientist shapes. So this was something, it's black wash with bright wash, and then I was coloring these yellow lines through, and everything has a reason. This was inspired by, I was sitting in the car, my wife was driving, and I was kind of doodling, and there was somebody on the radio, and they were talking about when the children, I remember their nurse, or what they call the person that takes care of them most of the time, the nurse to
Nanny.
Nanny was bending over the, bending over the crib, and her hair, long hair, you're talking about the strands and the patterns. And so I was sketching the book, and I'm, oh, man. So I merged this thought about hair and movement into the grid. And I also liked the way, as I pulled the brush, you know, I wasn't drawing a thing, I was kind of making the paint do something else. And I was dragging the yellow line from the black space into the white space, and things were happening. And that to me was what I wanted to do. So I kept doing that kind of work for a long time. To me, a long time was like 3 years. And I think one of the last ones I did was this, which, again, it's gouache, but I'm using the gouache in a way that is somewhat translucent or transparent. And I set rules for myself. I think it's part of my engineering, my architecture, my graphic design background. The rule on this one was, if I remember correctly, you start at one point, you move around, and then you exit at a point, the edge adjacent to it, not the opposite. So every line comes in, goes around once, and then either enters here or exits here. I can't remember now. They were all white lines except some were, this is my color, sense of color. Void you get red, orange, yellow, green, blue. Actually it's not blue, it's just red, orange, yellow, green. I'm not a colorist, that's why and part of the reason I'm not a colorist is I just never really learned the language to speak it. I know the basic grammar, I know how to create sense or paragraph with color, but I don't speak the language well. And so I gravitated more towards using values as a way of saying or doing it because I like it. But I really like this, and I call it nesting because it just seems to communicate that idea of nesting things coming together and making something else. So this brought me to other tangents, and I worked in charcoal for a long time, and then at some point decided, okay, caustics, wash, charcoal. I was buying a lamp from, now we're getting to this book, and I'm not watching the clock, but I'm thinking we'll be here for that now. So, why was that? I was buying a lamp from him, and he made these beautiful little Japanese structures and had these lampshades around them, doing different things. And he said, well, if you don't like this lampshade, I'll paint it a different color. And then, what do you mean? I thought it looked like rice paper. Some of them were rice paper, and some of them were not. As long as this translucent material I worked on, you paint it through the color. Because that's interesting stuff. Let me have some. So he gave me a piece. And I fooled with it, nothing really happened. I said, sell me another piece. So I had two pieces of this, and I thought, it's fun, it's nice, it's interesting. I'll take it with me when I go to Virginia. I used to go when I was teaching kids. It's a, you go to do work away from it. What? An arts retreat. I haven't been there in a while. So I went to Virginia to this artist retreat with this paper in mind. Maybe I'll work on this paper. And just before before I went, I saw Jim Dine give a talk at a school in Pennsylvania. And Jim Dine was one of the people, as a grad student, you know, 20 years earlier, as a grad student, I loved this work. I did a report on Jim Dine when I was in grad school. I borrowed slides from the son of Ben Bailey, which was Kennedy's work at the time. Slide part. I loved this work. And I copied these brushes in a sense. I copied, but everything I did was generated by some sort of success in some form of some image that inspires me. So he's giving this talk, and then there was a videotape, and he was showing the videotape. Well, I was watching him on the videotape, doing some huge, messy drawings on the wall, in chalk, throwing Pepsi at them. And I remembered stuff I forgot for the past 20 years about this physical engagement with the work. I was working with tight and small, and this was something I was interested in, and I kind of wavered away from it and forgot that I even left it. So I thought, I'm going to get some of that paper, which I thought was pretty big. It was 25 by 38 sheets. I'm going to do some big stuff when I go away. So I did. I figured out within a couple of weeks that Sui ink didn't work, acrylic ink didn't work, charcoal didn't work, but India ink seemed to do what I wanted it to do, which was stay on the paper and not come back when I every time I got it wet. So I learned now that Sui India ink on this paper. Synthetic paper, it's a printing industry paper, these catalogs. Now I'm going to get to more recent history. Does anybody have a question up to this point? But now it takes out when I started working with UPO. Okay, no question. This is printed on UPO. It's a catalog you can have it for $5. But there's a couple of you can look through. I printed this before I left Pennsylvania, so it's 5 years old, there's none of the current work, but it has something to do with the older work. And when I was away, I started doing lemons. So that these show lemons. And I was using two sheets of paper and making these wild lemons. And the lemons were there because two reasons. One, help me. The artist who does the black lemons, black lemons, the charcoal lemon. It's Moskowitz, maybe? I think so. Anyway, I used to like seeing his, these lemons, these black chalk. At the same time, my father was, at this point, he used some ciphers, and the only product of ciphers was used to be copper. That's how we use ciphers. But lemons. My father used to talk to me about lemons and ciphers. Biggest brand. So I did that, and then I had other problems with my mother and wife, more with family than with myself personally. And so I was feeling kind of upset. They were going to war. By the time I was in the East, I think we had already declared and getting ready to. And I was just thinking about and using me as a person who's suffering for one reason or another. And so I did a series of these heads on myself. Very, very upset and somewhat. Well, not really, I like them. My wife looked at this one when I did it, and she said, no, not this one, there's another one who's suffering. There are a couple of interesting essays. So these are more, my heads and more my head. This one's called Crash, just because it's it came from a story that I was doing this head, and again, it's not as long as that. It's narrow, but it's tall, but maybe a little narrow. And a kid I knew, well, he's my nephew, and he was in drug rehab in Pennsylvania, so we would see him. He lived somewhere else. We would see him, and we took him to the fights one night, and he described how this guy got hit, and his eyes just rolled through his head when he hit the ground. And so, this was kind of responding to that. And you can't see that one eye is losing a little bit of problems, and that was just kind of a response to his story that he told. So I was doing these things, my wife looked at this, now I know what to look like when you're dead. So I also was thinking of Eve's painting of Marat, who's wearing a towel on his head and slumped over the base and he's just been killed by, I forgot the other person's name. So most of all the pictures I do are based on somebody else's work, one way or another. So this is kind of my interpretation of Eve's death in Marat. But I don't title it that, and I never told anybody that before. They're like passing us on the back, like, I'm never going to see you again. She and my wife, I don't, but I mean, I can tell anything I want to really know. Yes, sir.
I'm sorry, I missed the beginning of the talk, but did you say how when you're working with yourself as a medium, if how you do it with mirrors or a photograph, or how do you do yourself?
Cameras. Digital camera. I'm not a lug-eye, but I'm not a tanky. Out there, you know, so I grabbed a visual camera. It was the first one of the three that I lost two. I still had the third. But before I lost that one, it was got the company Olympus. I had a nice remote. So I would just go push my head against the wall. Now I got to set up for 10 seconds. Eight, nine. And then it takes a little. So but that's how I got those kind of expressions. This was a friend of mine, a young friend, a student. We were talking, she was looking at slides and I was taking pictures. So all she was doing was holding on to the slides. I try to take pictures of people when they're not posing for a picture. I do it in conversation and then something clicks. And that's why I've only done maybe one or two portraits, because that means other person's gonna like it. If I do it to me, I don't like it. I just want to take pictures. So I shy away from doing pictures of people, because I'm used to make it flattering, and I don't want to do that. Mm. This picture of the girl was at one of these. The woman was at one of these residences, and her and I were about to leave, and I just kept looking at her face. I thought you had a great face. So I said, before you leave, I'll take pictures of you. And then about 10 years later, I found her name. I kept every once in a while I look up, what happened to her? And finally I found she's a faulty name, and I sent her a note saying, I'm using a picture and here it is. She felt very nice. That was it. I mean, she thought it was okay. I'm happy with it. I did other vegetables or fruit, green peppers. Again, easy. I'm happy you spoke of green pepper. Happy you spoke of pear. Once you got that basic shape, it's a pear shape. You say those things because they're so cliche and obvious. And skulls. Skulls have always been intriguing to me, not because of the death thing, but because I never understood them very well, and I was trying to do faces, and I thought if I'm going to do faces, I'm going to understand the structure. So I borrowed a real skull, which I want to come by. I mean, in some countries, of course, they just go all over the place, but you really have to make an effort. So I borrowed one from teaches anatomy and dissections, academical. So he's like a real skull, bad teeth, all that. It was really nice. So I worked with that for a while, just to understand the structure. I did.
I used to call them books, and I like them thinking about things.
So anyway, I just was doing things that seemed to be of interest to me, and my wife and the kids just, you know, they would say, do me. Why don't you picture me? Why don't you do a picture of me? I can't, because I, you know, it has to be pretty, it has to be nice. I like it. They said, well, at least do the dog. So I got it. This is four sheets. So I got to the point where I did four sheets, which means it was like 6 feet by a little more than 4 feet. So this is about 4 by 6. It was nice to do four sheets because I could I taped two edges, you know, and then I hang them, I hang two, or I hang the other two. And I could butt them up, and the paper doesn't do this a lot, so it holds tight. And I could ship them easily. You all fit in one box. You could have big paintings on the show in one box. And I kept asking the company, can I get the stuff in rolls? And they said, no. Can I get an end of the roll? And he said, well, maybe, we'll try. So can I just buy the roll? Can you make me a roll? I said, well, you can make a roll, but it has to weigh like 2,000 pounds or something. Because it's industrial. They're not going to just whip out 10 yards for me. So finally, they called me one day and said, Daniel Smith Catalog from California sells 77 pound cover, 5 foot by 10 inches. So that's why I've been using them. This is probably 144 pound cover. This book is prepared to a new one. This is probably 144 pound cover. So lighter than this is what most of these are. This is the heavyweight. 44-pound cover. Now we're going to talk about technique. So, any questions about anything before I talk about how I make the pictures I make? Because I've already tried to cover the wall. I'm still not sure. I don't know what the next picture is. The last picture I did before this week was of my granddaughter sitting at the piano in my house. And it's, I think, the first time I met a picture I've ever done since I've become depressed and upset and old. I like it a lot. It still looks like her, which is good. And I slaved over this. I worked on her face, I guess, easily 3 hours a day for like 5 days. And I kept changing. I kept erasing. I kept changing. At one point, I said, well, it's not going to look like her. It's going to be a kid at the piano. Okay? Okay? I'm saying this to everybody around me. Okay? My granddaughter's not going to be here. It's just going to be a kid at the piano. I can't get her. So I went through about at least a week of this, and finally I got the face. It had to be her. It couldn't be anybody else. So I got the face right, and I'm happy with the picture. And it's up on the wall, and I have it waxed a bit. Waxed. Yeah, that's the last thing I do is I wax it. I'll get to that. So it's unfinished in the sense that it's still might get some work. But I'm not sure. And then last week I did one, which is a takeover on the airplane. It's just bigger and a different kind of fabric. I started fooling around with unplanned events, like this whole background. Is not a plan. Okay, that's just messing around with the papers, walking on, not walking on, maybe rubbing it, pressing it down. And then I end up with something I look like it could be interesting, but what for? And I thought, well, it looks almost like an ocean, an explosion, to put an airplane in. So I did. The brushes are there. The brushes I made just because I like brushes. And I find it interesting to make it, and people seem to respond, which is another problem. Most people like these pictures. Most people didn't like these pictures. I mean, the people who voted yesterday don't like these pictures. they don't speak an easy language. And so I'm just so frustrated. See, we need to be sitting on our wall so long. I've always grown up knowing and believing, honestly, that good art requires some education to appreciate. You have to have knowledge of the language, you have to be able to discern something deeper than, great picture, looks just like a duck, looks just like a bridge, I love it. I mean, that's a very gross exaggeration of the two ends of the spectrum, but a lot of people like this, and it scares me, because how trite can they be if everybody likes them? And I'm filled with doubt. I think everybody who Well, maybe not everybody, but everybody I live with, which is, actually, my wife is not even sure about that. I'm even more sure about that. I don't know if I'm doing makes this great art. I know that some people like it, and that scares me because they didn't just like what else. The other things I did, which I thought was great art, and people watch TV. I can't watch TV anymore because most people watch it. Terrible thing. And if that's what most people are watching and liking, and this, oh God, maybe this is terrible too. So I'm not really sure. I like what it is, and I'm having fun doing it, and I'm still learning from it, and I'm still figuring out communicating what I want to communicate, which is sometimes obvious and sometimes not. So I'm at this point now, I'm somewhat comfortable with it, but always on the edge of being doubtful or feeling doubtful. So, technically, what it is, and I'll get to that, but any questions? Yes.
You may be going to get into this on the technical part, but I'm just wondering if you go back to the weight of the UFO, what weight do you normally use?
Exactly. Are you familiar with the printing industry? I didn't even know what 140 pounds mean, but it's a heavy thing. It doesn't weigh 144 pounds. Mm-hmm. But a certain number of sheets will weigh 144 pounds of a certain size, I think. Mm-hmm. So, the Comstock that I used to work on was this. 77 pounds is what I'm working on now. Now, does that answer the question or am I missing it?
Yes, I believe so, because the UPO that they sell, like Daniel Smith sells,
yeah,
I think it comes in three different weights, the lightest, and then a medium, and then a heaviest weight.
Well, because the heaviest is this.
Mm-hmm.
That's what I like, but it's just, you can't roll it.
Right.
You can't make a roll with
stuff.
Mm-hmm. I like it because I buy these rolls. They're nice size, and there's no memory to the paper. After you unroll it, it's flat. It's not like regular paper, your paper. You unroll it, and it's doing this all the time. I'm going to pass these out. These are bookmarks. They're also samples of the paper with ink on it. I hope I covered enough.
Thank you.
You didn't know what to expect. So this answers the question, physically, what is this stuff? It has Indian ink. Who do you have?
I have a few extra.
Oh, good. So, I'll take it. So this is UPO. It's plastic. Don't try to do this because it would just twist it.
Mm-hmm.
I used to use this, but if I'm not careful, I scratch.
Oh, yeah.
such rounded these edges, but even so, it's easy to scratch the paper. Good. So I used to use this a lot, then I realized I could use a roll. So what I'm doing is putting ink on the paper, rolling it around. I have spray bottles, which I didn't want to bring, just because you know what spray bottles are. And I have a spray bottle with water, a spray bottle with ammonia, and a spray bottle with water and ammonia. If the ink is wet, I spray water on it and push it around and stays wet. If the ink dries, I spray some ammonia in the water and that will dissolve the dry ink. If I want to push it around, I want to rub it off or something. I also have to work with this in one hand because the ink is not soaking into the paper, it's sitting on the paper, and grabbing it from the panel. So I'm going like this, pushing it up, and this is on, and it's writing it. But I'm not actually going all the way from working, but it's a combination of applying the ink, drying the ink, looking at the mistakes and the drips. And on this one, if I'm watching those drips come down and I like them, then I leave them alone. If I'm watching the drips and I don't like them, I rub them or I squeegee them or I brush them away. So I'm trying to allow the process to show through in the end. I'm trying to look at the ink as ink and not just as this, you know, what is it that makes the picture? I want to look like ink because it is ink. That's the abstract painting. I want to look like somebody or something because that's the realistic representation of the person. So I'm applying it with brushes. Sometimes I use a toothbrush to. And you'll see, if you look close, you'll see spots. What look like maybe I go like this, I probably go like that. Up in here, up in there. Probably because it's just a way of shading and it allows the white to show through. Like if I make everything gray, it's different than if you just put some little bit of black inside of the white to kind of get some different texture. So I apply it with this, I apply it with that, push it around and rub it off. Just like doing something. So there's no big trick here. It's like anything else. Put it down, put some down and take some off, and put some down and take some off, and then at the end, hopefully you didn't take too much off and put it down. You have something to show for yourself. This is, I brought this in as a sample. I had an open studio, I was just fooling around and demonstrating, and I grabbed a stencil and said, look, you can even do this. And I was rubbing off letters. Once it's dry, this is dry, you can scratch it off, water won't affect it, I don't have anything here with wine, so the wine doesn't affect it. Not much, it's mostly red. But if I once it's wet, I can kind of scratch it a little bit better. I think I learned that. Also, if you wanted to get rid of it completely, you want to scratch the paper. That would get rid of it, just scuff it. I knew from my days in architecture, and I knew that had served me somewhere, that to clean my repeated pens, I would soak the pen in ammonia. Ammonia and water. So I knew somewhere my answer that ammonia will dissolve in the ink, even when it's dry. So I guess if I apply ammonia to the surface, and that's not, it doesn't just disappear, it's not like magic, but it'll sit there and it will start to dissolve that ink, and then I can probably, not on a flat surface, but I can probably. Well, I took a lot off, but there was a lot there. So I haven't really gotten down. The nice thing is, if I keep rubbing and keep putting ammonia, what will happen is I'll go through layers of that ink, and I'll start to see things that are underneath it that I forgot about or didn't even realize. So I'm an impatient sort of thinking most. I gotta get have my coffee in the morning and start moving. So when I'm painting, I have no patience. I want to make a big picture, I don't want to take too long. So I figured out ways of working quickly. So this way, I can put layers and layers of ink, dry with a dryer, layers with a dryer with dryer, and then go back and start finding things that I might want to work with. Some values where I can just lighten and darken wherever I want it to. Then I discovered, there's some water right there. Can I have some water? I discovered this, which some of you know, those of you who have grandchildren, children. It's Mr. Queen's Magic. Now, if I'm painting this picture, this is my mother. I took this photograph of her, was just in conversation one day, and she was 87, she died at 88, so this was a year before she died. I got in some grief from some of that to the family because, you know, this is the way she looked in 1987, and she was, I mean, when she was 87, and she didn't always look like this. And, you know, we don't, but this was the woman that I was caring for a while, and this was the woman she had. And so I did this picture of her. But if you can imagine, I'm working with ammonia, and so if I'm up here and I try to bring these hair things out, which is probably a Q-tip dipped in ammonia, rubbed across, and then wiped clean, and it kind of just takes that line away. I'll give you my secrets. Yeah, I'll probably think of some more tomorrow, and I'll tell you about it. But there aren't any secrets, they're just things you figure out after a while. So the problem is, if I'm spraying ammonia here and I'm doing this, the ammonia is down here now too, and it runs the risk of dissolving everything else. And so I've got another here of water, and I'm flooding this water while I'm dripping the ammonia down, and it can be done, and it's, you know, burning calories, and it works. But then I realized, I found out somehow, that this magic, and I believe it's magic, water cannot dissolve in the ammonia. Probably water cannot dissolve in the ink. But if I wet the waterproof in the ink, or wet the sponge, and I rub the end of the ink, what probably is going to happen is, before too long, I can rub most of that off. This screen is a lot inky. But somehow, they invented something that doesn't scratch the surface. And yet, when we move right down to bare bone paper, well, that ended. Well, they didn't design it for that, but I found out that works. So now I've got something that, I don't have to smell ammonia. I don't have to worry about the ammonia dripping. Problem is, it really moves very quickly. Whereas with the ammonia, I can go down and down slowly. This is a little more aggressive. Now, I waxed. I waxed this part today just to show you the water. The water is just going to slide right off of this area. It won't stick at all. It's just coming right off. Because I've paste waxed that. And I can go back here and scratch this, but I can't go back here and scratch that. So when I'm finished, and I don't want the work to be damaged, just like you wax a car, if anybody used to wax a car, you rub it on and rub it off. It's called tree wax, T-R-E-W-A-X, or tree wax, I don't know how to pronounce it. And it's just a paste wax like the old Johnson's wax or Butcher's wax. And that now, then, it actually deepens some of the values. What is kind of reflective and not clear becomes still a little reflective, but deeper. Just like when you varnish an oil painting, it sort of grabs and pulls all the differences. So the wax tends to do that besides the tendon. Yes?
What, did you say tree wax?
It's T-R-E-W-A-X.
And where do you get that?
A good harvest.
Okay.
And they have clear and the yellow, but not clear for the reason. I used Johnson's wax. It's got a little more solvent, so it tends to remove a little bit of the ink. And it's gooey. It's just the way it's just. It doesn't have the canola that the other wax has, which is just a harder and better wax. Yeah.
I just wanted a clarification. So you said you don't use the ammonia anymore, you use the sponge?
No, I still do. I still, because of the ammonia, it's easier to control and get it slowly down.
Oh.
I don't use more ammonia, true ammonia, I might use it more down. So I have more control of the ammonia, but it's quicker. And if I want a really white thing, I'll use it with the sponge.
Right.
I use it with both. I just have it. The sponge was closest sometimes, you know, the sponge is there with the sponge, just like at home. You know, you want the red, you want the towel, you want the sponge, you just use it, it's there. The last picture I did, I'm just going to ramble down and look this up if you have questions.
So I have a question. The gloss that you're seeing on the paper, is that a function of the wax?
It's because the lighting sucks.
Yeah.
I mean, yeah, the paper is shiny.
It has a gloss.
The ink is shiny. At night, everything looks great because lights going down. Right now, we have a lot of reflections, which are bothersome, but, you know, paintings on the glass, the same thing happens, so I've come to accept it.
It's okay.
No, I know I'm looking for problems all the time. Otherwise, I got no one from.
It jumps out.
Yeah. Now?
Yeah.
No, I like it better this one.
I just have one other question. On your really large white shapes, is that wiped away or is it left for the most part? Or do you do both, you know, is it a combination?
It's probably, you know, it's probably left.
Okay.
And sometimes if it's left too much and it looks too white, yeah, throw some ink on it and wipe it off just because it looks like it's been worked through. It really wasn't, but doesn't, you don't want the paper showing. So.
I was just curious about, I guess, your working schedule. You know, every artist kind of points things up their own way, like, do I work better in the morning or the night, or how do I get myself started, or I get breakfast first and then work, or can I work, you know, that kind of thing. I just wondered how many hours a day you're able to work and how you schedule yourself, or if it works that way.
I get a show.
Uh-huh.
And then I have a deadline. And then I have to make it work.
I see.
So like the next show I have is in a few months. I gotta have these two big things that I haven't seen before for the show. That doesn't answer the question specifically.
Well, the
I don't have a schedule. I was just telling somebody, who am I trying to tell you, this former teacher?
Me.
Yeah, he said, well, I just started delivering Meals on Wheels next Monday.
Yeah.
I wrote in my book the other day, you need a schedule. Because I think God went, oh, what are you doing today? What are you doing today? Ah, oh, I got this and that. Now, this and that don't take that long, but I got all day to do it. And so I waste a lot of time. I have to have a deadline. I don't go to the studio if I don't have a deadline. It's still, because I've done so. I've taught, who needs another picture anyway? There's got to be a reason. And so the only reason is, if I have a show, I gotta put up the more work that I haven't seen before, otherwise it's the same damn show, and I won't be impressed.
Right.
And at this point, all I'm trying to do is impress myself. You know, because I taught for all those years and I thought, well, what can I do? I've sort of got people to do better than they thought for all those years. You know, and I did a lot. And I enjoyed it, but I hadn't pushed myself. So at this point, I'm just pushing myself to see, how far can I take this? I can't get much bigger because the studio room is 19. Although this way I can go like 12, then 12 foot pictures. But and nobody's ever gonna want these. So but I roll them up. You know, I buy a what do you call it, PVC tube and roll them up and put them in the corner of that room. They don't take up much space.
Yeah.
A picture like this might sit on the wall for 3 months. It probably only took less than 100 hours to do. But let's say I probably worked on it solidly for 3 weeks. But solidly to me is a couple of days from now, maybe 3 or 4 hours of work.
Right.
Maybe tomorrow I'll do an hour's work. And at the end of the week, I don't think I know I need 140 hours. You know, so you know, maybe it's 60 hours into the piece, which is not a lot of work. When you talk to somebody on Friday, how much work? 40 hours. What'd you do? Well, to me, 40 hours is. It's a lot of time to paint, but it's really not a lot of time when you compare to all the other things you've wasted 4 hours. So maybe that's that my sarcastic but honest to God answer is 35 years and 3 weeks. It took me 3 years of work to get to the point that I feel like this is what I can do and I want to do in 3 weeks. And I'll sit with it for weeks at a time if I work my accident. But no, I don't think I spent more than 4 hours in a row in the studio. I just don't have that kind of stick-to-itiveness or something. And so I look at spurts.
Yeah.
I might work 3 days or 4 days on a picture and do nothing for 3 weeks. It's terrible. Retirement. I don't find something to do. This picture is the last picture I did before I put the show up. I can talk about it specifically, but I don't know if there are any other questions because it's sort of like an hour long. I got that all day, but I think it was comfortable for both of us.
I'm interested in the technique of the lace. You can't do that with the sponge. You do
good. I hate that picture. Because, you know what, I thought, actually, why is that picture there? It's different than the others. I was watching Wide Open, which is the only thing I can watch at the beginning, but you've seen it before. I'm not watching Wide Open for some reason. I mean, you just leave the room, come back, and you know what's going on. You know what time it is, and you're going to admit to doing it or not. So it's an easy show to watch. We were talking about, it was the sex one, it's the special victims.
Yeah.
Somebody was selling panties online. This is a story of kids' panties. You could buy these like teenage kids' panties. Turned out their grandmothers selling their grandchildren's panties online, making a living because they had nothing to do, they had no income. So I went to the TV show, I got my laptop on my lap, and I was
maybe twice.
Panties. So I'm thinking of the panties. And then they mentioned only a few people in the room would know.
Betty
Boo, but the like
Betty White?
No. No, actually there was a movie about her, the notorious Betty Page. She was like the cheesecake woman years ago. And in those days, Garnabelle, the panty that I was in. So they mentioned Betty Page on the thing. And so I googled Betty Page, and I found this is called the web. And I found this picture on the web of Betty Page's and style. And I cropped it, you know, it was limited, I cropped it to this point, and I expanded it and projected it and drew every, the reason I said, hey, I drew every damn thing with a brush. Mm-hmm. I first had it projected, I penciled in all those loose lines, and then I might as well have sewn it, right? And even there's some broken blocks on the way, so that it, you know, broken pieces. So it's just a brush and ink, and I did it because I hadn't done anything that specific with a brush, and I thought, let me try this.
Yes, because you use the brush as its watery, like fluid feeling to it, it's very...
It looks like so.
Yes, it's very interesting.
So I figured I'm not doing this again, but I can do it. It was not fun to do because it was late, you know, it was just right thigh, left thigh. But I enjoyed it. I mean, I set a challenge to myself and I got to one of the colors. I like the picture. I don't think not too many people have mentioned it. That's just from a model, a girl, woman who works. She's a printmaker. She modeled at school. We love school in town. I met a couple times going into school. Asked her to do some posing, and she posed. And I ended up with that. I struggled with that, and I gave up on that picture a few times because I wasn't getting the face at all. And then after about 3 weeks, I decided I'm not going to go on with the picture. I'm just going to cover it up. So I went back to the studio and I had the ink. I just had the dirty water, the inky dirty water that I've been, you know, just been sitting in. And I didn't have any more ink, so I thought, I'm just going to put coats of, you know, watered down ink on it. And so I was doing that and white and covering the whole thing with ink. And when I got to here, I just was looking at these swipes that were coming across the face, and I thought, that's kind of adds something, because what was happening was I had this photograph that I took, and the photograph was gorgeous. And I was doing the picture, I was thinking, well, it looks like this is going to become a really beautiful picture, though it's just like a photograph. Well, what's the point of that? And I didn't know where else to take it, other than make it look pretty like the photograph. So I just got rid of it, and as I was getting rid of it, it looked like something else. It was no longer pretty, it was no longer... That whole thing across the face intrigued me. So then I went back and I had scrubbed off all this ink that was covering this. And then, so it was a white shirt, but then it was mostly black at this point, so I had to rub all that off. And I kind of found a different picture underneath the mess that I had made covering up the picture that was failing. Another one was interesting. I had one of these lawnmowers like this one. It was in the house for years, and I think it was my father's actually. And I was going to do a drawing on it. The studio I work in is 5 miles from the house. And I was going to go to the dump that day. That we call, you know, it's not the dump, it's a place that they deposit the stuff and then they take it to the dump. Mm-hmm. So I brought my stuff there and I was going to go back home, get the lawnmower, bring the lawnmower to the studio. And as I'm hunting my car, a guy in the pickup truck is full of junk. And I see this handle sticking up from the top. And I said, is that a mower? He said, yeah. And he lifted it up. I said, can I have it? He said, yeah. So he gave it to me. I took it into the studio rather than go home and get my other one. And this is so much nicer than my other one. This is one, the other one is metal, wooden handle, really great. So I had this sitting here for a while. I had the idea in my head for a while. So I brought that over, took pictures of it, projected the pictures, started working on it, and worked on it. And while I was working on it, it was the election two years ago. And I promised and said, this was back in 2001, I started doing the soldier film. I said, I'm not going to do color anymore. I'm too vicious at that. Because it's a dark time. And the day that Obama was elected, my daughter called me up. She says, well, are you doing color? And I said, no. I put some brown in the picture I did today. There's a little brown in the wood parts of this. But that's as close as I've gotten to using color in the past 10 years. I have a little bit here and there, but not seriously, not much.
So what's the brown? What meaning is that?
Oh, it's probably a little bit of ink. I don't know. Either Dr. Martin's ink or one of the other acrylic inks. It's probably an acrylic ink because I want to go in my face. And that's me. I had shoulder problems. I was recuperating from a shoulder operation about 8 years ago, sitting on the deck with that umbrella hat on my head, feeling sorry for myself, thinking what a fool I am. Sitting here in this wonderful autumn, feeling sorry for myself just because I had a shoulder. And I took this picture of myself, knowing that I looked just hollow. I was weak and thin. And so I took this picture and I'm searching for something to do. And I found this comment, just recently. And I found that photograph again, which I hadn't seen in kind of 5 years. And I thought, that's pretty funny. I'm going to do that picture. So I think he looks, I didn't look that bad. I mean, I think this guy looks sort of dangerous. I just liked that dangerous sort of look. So I pursued that. The brushes are academic exercises, there's no great theory behind it. So, the lemons were my father, that's my mother. I did one type of thing with my father, which I never really had to leave the house, it's just sketching it. And that one, that Hamilton Beach, for a long time, my mother was there. And my mother-in-law remarried a little jerk. And then he died, and we didn't even know it, and the sun cleared, everything else from the phone in Florida. It's one of those dudes. And so we went down and found an empty apartment, and nothing but junk. And my wife actually on the way down and said, I hope we get the Hamilton Beach. I hope we didn't take the Hamilton Beach, because that was just kind of a thing growing up. And I found that it just happened to be in a cardboard box away from the phone with junk. And so that's my brother-in-law's Hamilton Beach, and so that's why I did it. It's a very important personal thing for the family. I also went through things that have color, like the green peppers are green, and pears have a certain color, and that thing has a certain green that's very recognizable as the green of Hamilton Beach. Even though I really like my pictures, I think of the colors of these things as being indicative of everything about them. So I think I'm done saying anything that I had in mind. So if you have any questions, please.
Do you ever paint more than one painting at the same time? Do you ever work on them?
Yeah, I have more than two. And I have one on the wall that's been there for a year and a half, and I'm only going to take it. And I have another one I rolled up, and I'm not going to look at again for a long time. So I'll work on stuff and sometimes give up.
Yeah.
Or sometimes just leave it there, and once in a while I'll pull it. But usually it's one thing, at most two. I'm not disciplined enough to do more than one.